But the rocks that we care about have holes in them. And not only do they have holes in them, they have fluid in those holes, right? I mean, all rocks have holes in them. But the rocks that we care about have fluid in them, and that fluid changes the way the material responds. And I think we can all intuit this by, I mean, anybody who's ever picked up a sponge, right? You know, if you pick up a sponge, a wet sponge, and squeeze it, it feels different than a dry sponge, right? And if you could imagine that your sponge was closed celled, so that in some way you could imagine there's like a membrane covering your sponge, trapping the fluid inside of it, and then you were to squeeze that guy, then it would feel also much different. Likewise, you could think of, you know, a balloon filled with air versus a balloon filled with water. The type of fluid in there, if you squeeze that balloon, there's a different feeling, right? And that feeling is the material's resistance to the force that you're putting on it when you grab it, right? And those are all, in a way, in analogy with the things that we see in poroelasticity, elasticity, right? So, there's some assumptions in poroelasticity. And that is, you remember every time we draw our little cube that we're going to apply stress to, this is an infinitesimal cube that lives at a point, right? So now I'm going to draw this cube. And of course, our real rock has holes in it. Those holes we call porosity, right? And those holes are filled with fluid. And they're well connected so that, you know, the area between these guys, this is what you'd call grains. Grains. All of these would be, again, well connected. We're going to assume, for the purpose of this class, that all the pores and throats are fully saturated. We can, you know, in general, you can relax that assumption, but we're going to assume that pores and throats are fully saturated, and if you have some infinitesimal volume of the pores, DVP, and some total volume of the rock matrix, we're going to assume that DVP over DV is much, much less than 1. That is to say, in words, that the amount of porosity is very, very small compared to the amount of solid material. So that's the second assumption. The first assumption is there's an interconnected pore system uniformly saturated with fluid. The third assumption is that the total stress acting on the rock externally and the stresses acting on the grains are statistically defined. What that means is that we're going to assume that everything within our little infinitesimal cube of rock and pores is in equilibrium. And the stresses that act on this volume are, you know, we're not going to break down the individual stress on every grain, right? Because obviously in a real rock, there's contact forces between grains. The grains are different sizes and other things. And so the stress on every individual grain, if you were to go in there and measure it somehow, would be different, right? But what we're going to say is that in our poroelastic model, all of those things average out to one value, one stress. Okay. And again, this, since it's stress and we're talking about mathematical definitions now, or continuum definitions, so we shrink this whole thing down to a point. So in our model, you know, even though we draw it like that, in our model, there's really no try to think of how to say this correctly. I mean, there's, in our model, there's no picture like this. It's a continuum of superimposed porosity, fluid-filled porosity, and solid material. And they interact with each other in a way. And the way they interact with each other is through the concept of effective stress, which we've already talked about a little bit in the context of fault slippage. So here we have two definitions of effective stress. The first one is the one we've seen with respect to fault slippage, and that's the so-called Terzaghi definition or Terzaghi effective stress. Terzaghi was one of the first guys to work in soil mechanics. He did a lot of work in the 30s. And then later, a guy named Biot, who was really the godfather or father of modern poro mechanics, corrected, if you will, Terzaghi's definition, which includes this little alpha right here, and we call this alpha Biot's coefficient. And I say corrected, I don't want to say that it's not like some fudge factor. It's, so a lot of times when you take drilling and you have these ROP models or something, and the model starts with like 8.97. Anytime you see a model that starts with some weird coefficient in front of it, that didn't come from F equals MA. Right? Those are correction coefficients. Right? In this case, the alpha comes from mechanics. It just came from Terzaghi mostly dealt with soils when he did his work. And turns out alpha for soils is near 1. So a lot of his observations weren't incorrect because they dealt with soils. But when you deal with rocks, you have to take into account the effect of the compression of the solid material itself. And that's where this alpha comes in. And I'm going to